I think, you know, I've said this in my previous videos that I think, you know, if you're the only operator, you know, you've got to be kind to your future self. And what I mean by that is if you have a plan, make a strategy about your maintenance, you know, schedule and drills, and you know, try and stick to it. And part of that is I'm going to hit on some things. You know, spares are obviously a huge part of it. And you'll only know what spares you begin or need to carry with you once things start to go wrong. But there are some spares that I can help you with straight away. Everybody almost always will have filter problems or fueling problems. And, you know, your filters will get clogged. Basically that'll stop the flow of fuel to your engine. You're better off to get the gunk in your fuel filters than you are in your engine, because it's a lot, you know, a lot more work to try and clean out your injectors and stuff like that. So you're basically using these sacrificial filters to try and clean the fuel before it gets to the engine. And obviously the more filters you have upstream from the engine, the better chance you have of protecting that engine. So from a spares perspective, you'd be wise to carry filters, belts, and impellers, because remember the impellers are already sacrificial in their nature, and particularly if for some reason the flow of water gets restricted to the engine or the genset, then the impeller will start to melt, and little teeth or the fins on the propeller will then disintegrate. So I suggest that you carry at least one or two belts. And I'm getting some message here. Okay. I'm just trying to coordinate, you know, people getting on to the live stream or whatever. But anyway, so let's get back to things. Listen, spares, I think familiarize yourself. I've done my best so far, and I'm going to release a new video to everyone showing them how to do some maintenance on the main engine itself. When you buy a new boat, obviously everything's very clean. There's no fouling in the tubes. But as you start to progress and spend more life at sea, things get clogged. So I think what mightn't do you any harm is to get something called Barnacle Buster. And what you do is you put that, let it run through the system and then close its seacocks and let it sit in the system. It's basically a liquid that you can pour in the strainer. And the strainer is what takes the seawater in, filters it basically, and then sends it around through the cooling part of whatever engine it is, be it the generator or the main ship's engine. So I would say the other thing is make sure that at the beginning, you know, you get your warranty work done. Your warranty schedule is very important, obviously, because if you don't stick to your warranty schedule, then you don't have a warranty. But on top of that, like I've said in previous videos, if you get warranty work done, then, you know, watch the engineer while they do it and ask questions. Don't be shy to ask questions, because, you know, the more you know and learn about it when you have that skilled engineer, and preferably that'll be in Europe where you buy the boat. And so I suggest that, you know, you when you get an engineer on board, you want to watch what it is that they're doing. All right. And then what I would say is, you know, what helps with your maintenance is if you've got good equipment in the first place. And that's some of the stuff I'm going to hit on in the second part of my presentation. We're doing a bit of a mishmash because they're quite interlinked. Let's say if you've got good equipment in the first place, then it's a lot easier to maintain. One of the beauties, as I've said before in the Neel, is that you have the space to work. And most of the time on boats, obviously, that's a nightmare trying to get in a very tight space. And when you're in the tropics, it multiplies the difficulty by four because, you know, the sweat will be pouring off you. I'd say that a lot of people recently have chosen a shaft drive and quite a large engine for this Neel. I think they're going for a 120 horsepower Volvo Penta shaft drive. And although I recommend a shaft drive, it does make your maintenance schedule as now goes from a guaranteed year, to maybe a year and a half, 2 years on a shaft drive engine. So look, it's amazing that Neel are now giving a choice behind, you know, what engine you have, because a lot of yards just simply don't do that. But if you can have a shaft drive, I think it'd be good. But what I would say is one of the main reasons why I suggested getting a shaft drive is it, the problem that I find is with sail drives, generally you have this little propeller shaft seal, which can cause water ingress. So the obvious thing is to make sure you have spare seals for the propeller shaft seal. But I'm led to believe that Yanmar, in their sail drives, have this option where you could change the seal while the boat is in the water, and you can fully extract then after that all the water and the oil in the transmission compartment, which is wonderful because then you don't need to haul out the boat. All right. Mostly the sail drive isn't a huge problem because it's expected that for the anti-fouling, usually if you want to maintain the good performance of the boat to clean the hulls, that you're essentially going to haul out the boat probably every year anyway. If you have a good anti-foul, and this is part of maintenance, and I suggest you get the non-ablative anti-foul from Hempel in the red. I've tried a few anti-fouls from Hempel, but the non-ablative one, because this is a fast boat, what will happen is if it's ablative, it diminishes as time goes along, whereas the non-ablative tends to stick a bit better. Doesn't work so well with barnacles, but barnacles are easily dealt with. You just get a spatula, kind of a paint stripper spatula, and just scrape the hulls. So scraping the hulls and maintaining the hulls will maintain the performance of the boat very significantly, actually. And, you'll be able to maintain that, six knots and six knots of wind on a reach, which is incredible with just the working sails in this boat for all the space that you have. I think it's pretty incredible. So the other thing is, keep all your warranty documents for the generator, and Neel, the ship comes with an owner's manual. And I suggest that you keep all your warranty documents, even for the dinghy, for the outboard. I suggest that you have proof of purchase as well for these, because especially for the electronics. So you have proof that you've bought it. So if you get solar panels, any extras that you have on board, keep the documents that you have a proof of purchase. And that, if you can, during that warranty period, of course, make sure that it's serviced by, a certified engineer. That brings me to my next point. I wholeheartedly cannot recommend B&G equipment. Although I haven't actually bought them, I think proof is in the pudding in the fact that a lot of the racing folks, they're using NKE equipment. And although it doesn't look as pretty because it's a low energy consumption equipment, a bit like a Kindle reader, let's say, which is very low energy requirements, there are some benefits with it. And so what I'm suggesting, and it's kind of hinting on the next topic, but, don't go with B&G. Everybody I know and all the more, let's say, experienced sailors seem to have a lot of problems with it, especially the exploration sailors that I'm reading or spoken to. I'd rather have a piece of equipment that is reliable than one that has all these bells and whistles. So remember that I think that's probably, the last thing you want to do is be waiting for post to arrive with replacement equipment. And that maintenance aspect, I'd suggest that if you build a new boat, that you stay around the region of La Rochelle, and that for at least a week, you purposefully sail upwind and give the boat a bit of a hiding going upwind so that it'll thrash out all these problems. It's the upwind sailing that really seems to bring out the flaws in anything. What I would say is that, as I mentioned, the autopilot, you can save yourself a lot of money. Autopilots, NKE, do a whole range of things. And they're, as I said, the racing nature. You can get a little remote, for example, for man overboard and all these things. But I've actually had quite a lot of maintenance as far as the B&G, the radar. It's quite quirky and a little bit over complex. So what I suggest that you do is get stuff that other people in the sailing community have found excellent. And there's one company that do a unit called, it's called a Vespa Cortex. And what this provides you with is very good AIS, which is your automatic identification systems. So I think when you combine the NKE stuff, which I won't get too complex, but speaks its own language, And with the Vespa Cortex, once you connect these two, Vespa Cortex, basically what it has is a thing called a multiplexer. And over Wi-Fi, you can hook in with your laptop. And therefore, that means you can get all the information from the ship onto your laptop or your notepad and walk around the boat or be in your bed and, you know, have all your alarms set up using whatever software you want to use. I suggest OpenCPN for somebody that's starting off. OpenCPN is excellent and it's free, but you have to buy your charts, but it's excellent. And I said that, you know, you need to, if you can get charts, the Navionics that would come, say, you would classically buy with a B&G is okay in developed places. But as you start to go more off grid, I definitely wouldn't be relying on the Navionics only. I found it very, very bad in some areas. So what that means is you're going to be using on your laptop satellite pictures, along with as many charts as you can get your hands on. Buying it, if you're going in a region, just get as much as you can, especially if you're going for that exploration type sailing. As part of maintenance, there's a little acronym called WOBBLE, and so the WOBBLE, as in wobble, the word wobble, and it's an acronym. So the W in WOBBLE stands for water, so you want to check that you have enough water for your passage. So why not fill up your tanks completely and also have spare water? Make sure your ditch bag has water that, you know, is drinkable. When I say ditch bag, that's obviously the bag that if you should come into the extreme emergency that you can take a bit of water with you. I can tell you, after a very stressful situation in any context, you find that you have a very dry mouth and you could do with a lot of water. A lot of sweat comes off. So it's best to replenish that. If you feel thirsty, you've already left it too late in some instances. You know, your body's naturally telling you that you need water. So a wobble, W-O-B-B-L-E. So you've got the water and then oil. So you want to check that your transmission oil and your engine oil is at sufficient levels. So you're going to use the dipsticks for both and make sure that you have some spare with you. One of the benefits of the Volvo Penta D275 and its sail drive, they use the same oil. But most boats are not like that. Transmission oil is generally a different, different number. So make sure you have spares for both. And you could argue also that you should also have oil for your outboard engine, which is also a different type of oil. Some people think, like certainly my experience in motorbikes, some people make the mistake of putting synthetic or fully synthetic oil when actually the engine is designed for non-fully synthetic oil. Be careful what you choose. Just follow what it says. You know, there's a serial number for the type of oil and the viscosity and the quality of the type of oil that you should use in the engine. So make sure you don't make that mistake. So the water, the oil, the bilge is the other B. So you should check your bilges, see if there's any water. And I suggest that you always keep your bilges dry. Some people make that mistake. And the reason being that obviously, lying water and standing water creates insects, and it can create an unpleasant, boat smell. But it also means that should you take on new water, you can identify the fact that it is in fact new water. That's what I'd say about that. Batteries. So the next B in WOBBLE is for batteries. And this is obviously you're checking very easily just next to me here by the stairs of the nav station. There's a little switch that you can check the engine and the genset battery simultaneously. And you 12 volts actually for an engine battery is a little bit low. Usually it should be sitting around 12 and a half or 13 volts. So that's just a pointer that I should let you know. If you see it sitting at 12 volts, you're probably if you can get the engine started, you need to let it run and let it charge. And in that regard, if you find that the battery doesn't really get up above that, you've either got a faulty battery or a faulty way of charging it. So you need to look at maybe the engine alternator. It is probably maybe faulty, or so you need to keep an eye on that. So also I would say in batteries, it's a great one because you should make sure that your handheld emergency radios are charged. And also in our life vests or life jackets, we've got some EPIRB style devices, which you can simply just press a little test. And so you should become quite familiar. You can unzip the whole mechanism in a life jacket and check that all of these things work. They have a test button on them. So you just see if the little light flashes. And also another interesting point is that I use an Iridium Go. and it's not great battery on it, and you almost always have it fully connected to power, USB power anyway. So I have a little hub sitting at the nav station that I just connect all the little SATCOM devices. And then later in future videos, I'm going to ostensibly be showing you some of the internal equipment that I use, quite advanced stuff actually. I'll be showing later on, but this watch is quite incredible because it can, in expedition mode, this is a Garmin watch. It's Garmin Instinct, it's called. It can do, can take a log for you every hour as long as it gets a satellite fix. So this does take a lot of risk out of if you're too tired and you've forgotten to take your log every hour. It can get you back, or you can even put your end waypoint in, a waypoint to an approach, so that, you know, if you're really snookered, this can lead you in. But of course, you've also should have a laptop or something that's tracking your progress through the ocean. Anyway, so the next L in wobble is leaks. So you should be checking your lines, and it's, you know, having a nice engine room means that you're down in it more. Now, I suggest you watch a video from a very experienced sailor called Skip Novak, who's just released a ship called Pelagic 77. And what he has done, he has deliberately designed the engine room so that you need to, on a daily basis, go down and change or do something in it. And that is very shrewd, because by walking down into the engine room, you're more likely to see a problem or an oil leak. All right. So if you see leaks, don't set off. Get it sorted, because as soon as you start running the engine or you start going upwind or in the seaway, then this leak is almost certainly going to become worse. All right. And so on the wobble acronym, the last E is electricity or electronics. So, you're basically... You know, you want to make sure all your devices are working well. You know, you want to make sure that your breakers aren't working. And we've got little things like added another freezer or fridge, a portable one, kind of like what you get from Dometic. And that's pretty important that the little plug doesn't come untouched or everything. So, you know, you're gonna create your own pre-flight checks, let's call it pre-sale checks. And you know, you'll be surprised if you can get into the habit of doing this. Like all things in life, good habits reap their rewards big time. And you can see sometimes if you're in ports, you'll see some people open their sails on a light wind day in port, and that's to get, you know, the mildew and stuff. But it also just checks your running rigging. And electricity is part of electricity is making sure you've got fuses and that your electric winches are working. Electric winches, although when they fail, usually you can go back to just using the manual winch handle. But, you know, all of these little checks can leave you in good stead. So let's go back. So that's the wobble. That's got you sorted. I've touched on a multiplexer and a laptop. I think those are very important because they save a lot of energy. But I suggest you always keep a paper log. I keep one, a paper log here. And, you know, what you keep in your log is quite personal, but ostensibly what you're doing in a log is you're being kind to your future self in an emergency. So you obviously put where your position is, where your heading is, and where you're steering to, so you know, can know where the current is. And you give yourself, you're planning ahead so that should you have an all electrical failure or have a major issue, you at least have a port of refuge, or you know where you're going to go to. So you have your destination and you'll have a port of refuge. But I'll go through that in much greater detail in other videos. There's a few things as far as maintenance. I've mentioned, I've touched on oil, but what I suggest that you also have is pre-mixed coolant. You can carry maybe like you can get a gallon or which is whatever, it's about 4 liters or something, about that much engine coolant. Spare, but pre-mixed. You know, some of them are concentrate and then you have to add water. Don't like them so much because the quality of the water can vary and can have a lot of high calcium concentration in it. So you're better off to have the pre-mix, which is with distilled water. There is something that only people that have been sailing for a while that I know about. There's a very good epoxy called Splash Zone Epoxy. And there's a lot of epoxies, but splash zone epoxy is very attractive because let's see, I'm seeing do I have a problem with my, I'm just checking the volume, not sure that I have good sound coming out here. Check. No, not sure that this is working. It might have frozen on me. But anyway, I'm just going to finish up this stream then, and then we can maybe start another one. But anyway, backsplash zone epoxy is an epoxy that you can apply underwater, and that is beautiful. It's very expensive, but it's very worthwhile, and I suggest that you keep it in your repertoire. Mentioned in my previous videos that I suggest that you don't go for any Goyo hatches or the helm. A company called Goyo, it's spelled G-O-I-O-T. I just hate their stuff. They have a higher spec hatch, which is used in exploration vessels, which seems to be okay. But the lower specification hatches, I'm not that keen. I've talked about wobbles. One thing that you're going to do is you're going to look at your standing rigging and your running rigging and the shackles that are used there. You know, there's a strong argument that if you're going to be doing the miles on one of these boats, that you you know, you upgrade as best you can the shackles. So make sure that they're rated. You know, they have a number rating for what tension they have, and particularly the ones like in the Genoa, because Genoa, you know, if you push the boat, those shackles are what keeps the Genoa on the furling drum, things like that. Or, you know, the halyard for the Genoa that lifts the Genoa up to the top of the forestay. Those shackles will be under quite a lot of attention. So, you know, I would look at, you know, even some people, you can, in the racing boats, they use Dyneema, which obviously can chafe, but, you know, I suggest that you look at that one and the jib as well, you know, how those are attached on. So maintenance is part of looking at your running rigging. You know, it's nice if you don't want to go up the mast, then pay someone a few quid to, you know, to go up and check all your equipment. And they'll, if you get a pro rigger, they'll find things, and with their experience, you get what you pay for. So it's better to have a problem or get that stuff sorted or prevented when you're in port before you go to sea, obviously, and the problem occurs. So what I would say is I've been researching a little bit, and the equipment that you get from a company called Carver, which is in Lorient in France. I think there's one in La Rochelle too. I don't think you could go too far wrong with Carver's equipment. And if you didn't want to invest in electric winches because it's a bit pricey, they have a very nice speed and power winch version. And the speed winch, obviously, it's faster, takes things in more for racing boats. But the power winch is as good as a 60 series winch. And there were 52s on this vessel. The biggest thing that causes maintenance issues really is the aircon. And as you've seen, I've given some videos before, but I've added a bilge, a little suction pump that I can control on the 12 volt batteries, a little switch. And that basically, it allows you to, it just makes things a little bit easier when cleaning up, and having a bucket as well when you're opening sea strainers just reduces your overload, and having all the animals, which can begin to smell pretty quickly. Definitely suggest carrying hose spares. Of all the diameter hoses that you have on board, you know, keep at least 3 meters of all the hoses that you have. Another thing about, you know, water sensors, you know, water gauges and fuel gauges quite often fail. So always keep, when you fill up, always keep a log of when you've last filled up the tank to max, and how, get a good idea of how many miles you've done, because with this engine, it uses about 1 liter per mile. And then you can see the engine hours on the gen set. So you should have a good idea about what fuel that you've used. Then another point I would say is with maintenance, it's as good as whatever tools you have, and cleaning and you know, general maintenance is pretty important. Stick with the same brand. So this is one brand that I highly recommend. It's Ryobi. This drill, absolutely love it, and the bits with it. Great, great piece of kit. So, you know, these drills can be quite expensive, and you get what you pay for, because they die pretty quickly unless you buy a good one. There's another company called Milwaukee. You'll never go wrong if you buy any of this kit. This is pretty high-end Rolls-Royce type kit. And you can see, like, for example, I've got what's very useful is a step bit. And these step bits, trust me, it's gold dust. It's fine if you're in somewhere, you know, let's say civilized like the United States or, you know, in Europe or UK. But as soon as you go off grid, you're never going to find a step drill bit. You're not at all. One of the things that you'd want to add to your repertoire is one of these little jobs, very cheap, about $15, but it's a multi-tool and you can add almost anything. At the moment, I've got a sander head on that, but you can have a cutter or anything, just extremely useful, just absolutely slices the workload down to next to nothing. And I have a little very cheap plane, you know, like a sander, you know, for doing, you know, it just sands the little roughness out of the deck or anything like that. Also, I have a boat polish, but as far as maintenance, the point, one of the things I would say is if you're going to buy a new boat, I would suggest you just get decals on the boat. It reduces your workload with polishing and, you know, just get, you know, stickers, decals that just stick on the hulls and give you whatever color that you want of the boat. And you can do a cool design or whatever you want on it. They're a bit, it's a bit of a fashion thing, but you can just go for one solid color. Then you don't have any polishing. So polishing is a lot of work when you get into port, trust me. For maintenance, simple, but very important. That is your normal wrench, but look, it's got a little automatic thing on it. And there's a little ratchet. That little ratchet is, those are gold dust. Get those, whatever way you want to do them. See this point bend so you can get in at angles and, you know, use the ratchet. Very useful piece of kit. Also, maintenance, that stuff for cleaning the deck from tuna blood, any type of blood or rust. That stuff is absolutely incredible. It's anti-oxide, so it smells pretty bad. It's probably not great for you, but for cleaning decks and anchor, by where the anchor chain, you know, blows off a little bit of rust, that is great. So, and then stick flex, silicon stuff. This is the 5-day cure, not great, but there's a red one of this. This is by 3M, but get the red one of this and get lots of small tubes, not one big tube. Get lots of small tubes because once you use it, it's going to dry out. So get lots of small tubes of that. And then, so this is the engine CPU for the Volvo Penta D275. And as you've seen in my previous videos, I had an engine failure, but this little CPU, once this fails, you're going to have a few problems and it's going to be quite irritating because your anchor chain won't be able to work and lift up your anchor. So, you know, there's a lot of things depending on your engine generating electricity. And I'd suggest that rather than hot wiring and get the engine working, but it won't be charging any of the systems, you need that to charge the systems, get your anchor and stuff up. So I highly suggest you get a spare one of those. Really useful piece of kit. And in the video, I showed you that you can hot wire your engine by connecting two of those terminals. So that's the engine CPU. That's a pretty critical thing that you would have. It's very unique to the D275 series engine. Other thing is that if you're at sea making water, a block filter can just simply stop you making water. So I've got a big collection of 5 and 20 micron filters. And so I'll always be able to make water. The water maker itself is extremely reliable. So as long as you have filters, should be able to continue to make water. Now, I'm seeing that I'm not sure that my microphone is working too well, but I'll continue on and I'll just have to do this video again, the live stream again, because I'm not sure that the sound is recording that well. Anyway, I was kind of hoping that Oliver Delarue would join me. And Oliver, listen, if this doesn't work or it's not satisfactory, I'm quite happy to do a Zoom with you. Neel pointers for buying a new boat. I've kind of touched on some of them already. I think stay around for at least a month, stay close to La Rochelle so that any issues you can just sail back into La Rochelle and get them fixed very quickly under warranty. And make sure you sail for, you know, good 5 days upwind, and that'll, you know, really shake it down. I'm not suggesting you go out in very bad weather, but, you know, give her a good shakedown. It'd be good for you as well. Extended warranty on an engine. If you're going to be doing the miles, which almost certainly you will be, almost everybody does that buy one of these boats for doing big miles. So, you know, see about, you have to buy an extended warranty within 6 months of buying the engine usually. So get an extended warranty on whatever engine it is that you decide to buy. I think investing electric winches when you're really tired and you're doing big offshore passages is worthwhile. If not, then go for that carver power winch, certainly on the furling, winch, and also get that carver power winch, the power series, and get it on the it's the Genoa sheets, you know, which is the far port winch, which is the most hardest to pull in. You could argue that, you know, with as big as Genoa we have, we push the winches pretty hard, and they're quite small. You'd always do with upgrading a set of winches if you just wanted to go manual as well. So worth looking at, but I wouldn't scrimp and save. And the same thing goes for if you're going for any furling sails, like a Code Zero or an asymmetric. Asymmetrics, although they're popular with cruising, they're pretty big on this boat. And I think you probably get more value with something like, you know, a Code Zero. Code Zero would probably be easier to handle and use it more. And I probably, a low incident sails are great. You know, the Elvstrom, pretty good. Incident sails and generally quality are pretty good. But what I don't like about the running cars and the battens, you know, the battens that go in the sail, you've got the battened end caps. Don't like them. I would suggest that you buy good ones from Carver. You know, you're going to have to pay for them, but they're good. And I've said that about upgrading rigging. If you want, I can talk to you a little bit more about what are my views on rigging personally, or I can do some more suggestions and send you some links and good rigging. Make sure you buy, they're only about $5 or, you know, whatever, but it's a non-return valve. It looks a little bit like a duck caller for when you're hunting, and very similar, but it's a non-return valve, and you just put it, well, you have the through hulls above the waterline, you put this non-return valve to stop the water splashing back in and going down your bilge pumps. Just put them everywhere. It's kind of standard procedure, but I don't know why Neel didn't do it, but I suggest doing that in all of them. I think before you even start the whole process of buying something, I think, you know, getting an agent, you're not just giving commission away to some, you know, some greedy sales dude. It doesn't work like that. If you get a good agent, and the one from the UK, MI Katz, I highly recommend him, and I have no agenda for saying this. He did a great job for me. And usually the agents aren't very well liked by the shipyard because they kind of police it, the shipyard, through the whole process. But Mark of MI Katz, Mark Asprey, I highly recommend, and I think it's worth, you know, the fee that you're giving him rather than going direct to the shipyard. And I would say make sure the contract that you have is with the shipyard, not with the agent. If you know your law, you'll understand my reasons behind that, because the agents are usually their company is usually not worth a whole lot. So I suggest that if you have a problem, that you have your contract with the shipyard. And personally, I would have my contract governed by British law if you can achieve that. Because obviously I'm British and I know the law system there. I suggest, you know, you get some advice, and I can speak to you personally about that one. Don't ever rush a shipyard to manufacture your boat, ever, because these guys are under pressure to build anyway. If you rush them, they'll cut corners. So never, ever, ever, ever rush a shipyard to finish your boat on a deadline. Okay. Let's see. What that agent's going to do for you as well is, in the manufacturing process, you'll get their knowledge, or you could even get a surveyor as well during the manufacturing process, just to keep an eye on how things are, you know, how the build process is coming along, and are they happy with it. So, you know, I've got to be careful what I say, but some people say that there's a problem with the quality of the molding. I don't think so personally with the Neel. And the proof is the fact that anybody that says they've had a problem has been able to sail their boat perfectly well without any major disaster. But anyway, some people have said that they've had some problems with the gel coat. Listen, a boat is mostly epoxy, fiberglass, and gel coat. So what do? You carry some extra epoxy, some extra fiberglass, and some extra gel coat, and then you can fix the problem yourself, because these boats are hand built, you know, and you've got to expect that there may be some small problems, but they're generally not something that is going to, you know, leave you floundered, you know, sinking your ship in the middle of the ocean. You know, this is part of the normal process, that, you know, you get small places where a little bit of water ingress might have come in, and you just simply put either a bit of silicone or a bit of epoxy or whatever on it. So you get my point. I've said that I put a suction pump for maintenance down below. So, you know, add that extra suction pump, it'll just make maintenance a little bit easier for cleaning up water, or should you have an emergency or you've forgotten something, left something open, or you've had a burst pipe, just put a suction pump with about, you know, 10 meters of hose on it, and then you can get anywhere in the tech or engine room, or even in the very stair. And one of the last pointers, it's a bit of a weird one. I suggest that you don't ever have toilet paper on a sailing boat or a ship at all, because let me explain that the marine toilets from Sani Marine that the shipyard installed, excellent. The toilet itself is excellent, but the outlet for the bathroom or the toilet itself, the head, as some people call it, is actually less than an inch. And so it's less than an inch, and that meets a 1.5 inch seacock, I think it is, once it leaves the ship, you know, that goes through the through hull. And so you know, the normal sewer pipe is about that diameter. So you can imagine, even with a macerator, you're likely to going to get problems. And that's why sailing boats and boats in general have problems. So the best thing you can do is install a $30 or a £30 bidet and a water mechanical one, which is basically just, it sits on top of your toilet seat and has a little switch on it that, you know, you wash your bits, and it's actually more sanitary, and that does the job and saves you a lot of hassle, because I can tell you there's nothing more humiliating than unblocking toilets when you have a guest on board that just doesn't know how ships work. And that is what I would say. That is about the only difference that anybody coming on board that's never sailed in their life will have to get used to living on this boat, apart from the sea, the movement of the sea. That is it. And that is my last piece of advice I'd say to you. Before you invest in a large ship and you have your partner, make sure you charter and make sure that nobody gets seasick, because seasickness for extended periods, even for a short period, I've actually witnessed it with my own eyes, people just begging you to kill them with seasickness. So make sure, although your dream is very clear, make sure that everybody that's going to be your permanent crew is accustomed to that style of lifestyle. And also the more time that you spend educating your, you know, together, your partner or your crew, whenever a stressful moment comes, you'll be well versed in it. So stress is simply the perception of lack of control. So if you have more information, it therefore gives you the perception of more control, and therefore it makes it easier for everyone. So listen, I'm not entirely sure whether this live stream is working, so I'm going to publish this now and make some comments, and if need be, I can do a quick Zoom, particularly with Oliver, and we can do a quick Zoom, or we can just try again. Okay, so listen, thank you very much for your continued support, and I hope to see you on some other live streams and see some more comments from you all. Thanks very much again.